My name is Nick Meier, and I'm with the Tree Nut Improvement Lab. We operate here out of HARC. We work on chestnuts, black walnuts, hazelnut, hybrid hazelnuts, some European hazelnuts, and then we've recently started working with elderberries. So, but what I'm gonna talk to you today about is our black walnut improvement program, which was started by Mark Cogshaw, who maybe you could raise your hand. So he's really the person that started this and has curated this program. And me and Dr. Ron Revord are just now sort of inheriting this program. And our goal is to continue this research and build off the success that Mark has had over his career. So I've got some handouts if you're interested. We've got a grower production guide, so we can maybe pass these around. So Mark started this program in 1998 with the goal of domesticating the eastern black walnut as an orchard species. And so that means several different things. That means increasing the nut yield and increasing the size of the kernel so that it's easier to shell. And then there's several other attributes like color and shell thickness. So thinner shells are easier to crack. So these have been the main objectives of our breeding program. The original genetic resource that was used to start the breeding program consisted of 64 effectively wild selections that growers, enthusiasts had identified in the wild or as chance seedlings from lots that they had been sharing. I think a lot of this material came from the Northern Nut Growers Association and probably the Missouri Nut Growers Association. And so all of those trees were planted here at HARC, grafted onto Thomas rootstock. And we'll tour one of these orchards after this talk. And we'll give a little bit more context about the cultivars and their performance over the last 25 years. But that's the basis of the breeding program. And then after 20 years of evaluation, we use that data to help us design crossing schemes to develop that next generation of advanced walnut selections. And the goal is after generation, we get a little bit closer to something that's much more commercially available, easier to shell, bigger kernels, lighter color. We're not trying to be the Persian walnut, but there are some traits that the Persian walnut has that we think would be beneficial for the eastern black walnut commercial market. To date, there'd been a multi-year evaluation of 156 preliminary selections, and we've got 9 of those that seem to be exceptional. And those are the basis for our preliminary release program. So if you're an early adopter grower and you would like to start off with the most advanced breeding material, you can talk to me and we can talk about designing an experiment on your farm that will allow you to be one of the early adopters of the advanced breeding selections from this program. And if you really want to get all the details about the selections here at HARC, please check out this paper. It's very new. It's fresh from the journal, so please check it out. Next one. So here we have, I'm going to show some tables. Probably should apologize for showing tables. This is meant to be a little more detail-oriented. These are some of our top selections. I said 9, but there's one or two that fluctuate in and out, so maybe it's more like 11. We have some of the parentage here. So we have the female parent, and the male parent. And then we have the percentile of kernel percentage, good percentage, nut weight, trunk diameter, spur bearing, and we have an index sum. And the index sum has been the basis for the selections. So the selections that have the highest index sum are the ones that we deem most suitable to nut production. And you see selection number one is a somewhat low yielder, but its nut weight is good and its percent kernel is excellent. Here is Mark's program pedigree. This is where it all started. It's a little more detailed version of what you just saw without the data. So I want you to pay attention to this slide because this is where Ron and I inherited the program, and I'll show you where we've gone since 2019, and I'll show you where we would like to go in the future. So here's a little bit more about selection one. So this is our top kernel percentage cultivar. It produces a very nice nut, very very thin shell, and very low defect rate. Its only downside is it's not the heaviest producer. But when it comes to kernel overall kernel quality, it's the top selection. We're not sure if this one's going to make the cut because the yield is kind of low, but it is an exciting parent that we can use in the next generation of breeding stock. This one we're calling selection number three, extremely high yielding cultivar. So it produced 1,295 nuts in between years 5 and 8. That's exceptional yield. It produces predominantly on the spurs that occur on lateral branches. And it is very productive. It seems very suited to orchard production. The branches become very pendulous because there's so many nuts on it. It's pretty good kernel percentage, 34-36%. And for a little bit of context, a wild black walnut, the percent kernel is somewhere between 13-16%. And a advanced Persian walnut, the percent kernel would hover around 50%. So we're getting closer for sure to the Persian walnut, and much better than your native wild walnuts.
You say Persian walnut, what is? Is that like an English walnut?
Yes, English walnut, Juglans regia, the white. You know, the one you buy at the store.
And they're about 50%?
They range upper 40s to mid 50s. They actually can range higher, but the issue they get when the kernels become so big, the shells become so thin, that when they fall out of the tree, they break, and that induces spoilage. So we're thinking 50 is like a really good number. Walnuts are outcrossing, so it's definitely helpful to have multiple cultivars. And then it spreads out the risk of, if you only have one cultivar, it might be susceptible to a disease, whereas another one might be resistant. And it spreads out the harvest window by having different maturities, so you don't have to harvest everything at the same time. This one is selection number two. This is probably the thinnest shell cultivar that we have. Very good percentage. It's really close to selection one on percent kernel, but not just a hair less, lower percent kernel. Defect rate is really good. So we're really excited about selection two. There may be some alternate bearing issues with selection two, but in years it produces, it really produces. So once we grafted the trees out of the original orchard, we planted the selection orchard of the selections along with some commercial checks so that we can compare the individual trees to trees that producers already have adopted. And those would be Neil, Sparks 147, Brown Nugget, and Sparrow. I know if you're a walnut producer, that makes a lot of sense, but if you're not, these are basically the wild selections that are shared most consistently throughout the walnut growing community. And so all the selections we have here, and I'll show the data in a second, They compete very well with the wild selections and outperform them generally on every category. So here's the data. What I think is the most important characteristic is the in-shell yield. So that is how many kilograms each tree produces after the hull has been removed. And you can see comparing the selections to our commercial checks, really there's basically no contest. So the yield has, especially with selection two, is basically double what you'd expect from Neil Sparrow or Brown Nugget. But yeah, some of the other trees are also very, very high yielding. They all have trade-offs, but selection two and three are, you know, sort of leading the pack right now. Then here is that basically that same slide, but with the kernel percent kernel and kernel mass. So we haven't figured out how to beat Neil in terms of kernel mass, but I don't know if we necessarily need to have the biggest kernel as long as the shells are thin and the percent kernel is high. So selection one is really the only one that stands out above Sparks 147, which a lot of growers definitely have Sparks 147 in their orchards. It's an exceptional tree, but when you compare all the different traits, yield, percent kernel, all the selections would be a little bit better than Sparks 147. But in terms of percent kernel, it's still a, you know, one of the top trees around. And selection one, that's the first tree we showed you. It's definitely definitely a little bit better than Sparks 147. So in summary, so selection two and five, they're doing really good on kernel yield. Statistically, the power is still low, but we're getting there. And then selection one has like very, very exceptional kernel percentage, but the yield's a little lower than we'd like. And we're using this data as support for the preliminary release program.